We will continue from where we stopped last. And before that, we'll have a quick recapitulation what we discussed in the last classes. So we were discussing stylistics and the historical background of stylistics. And we have seen that different movements, Russian formalist, Czech structuralist, how they were responsible for giving a base to modern day stylistics. And we will also see in due course that there is some extension in the stylistics, which was in earlier days to be known as poetics. So that extension we will see these two movements, structuralism and formalism. They provided a base to modern day stylistics. That's quite important to know. And there are certain prominent figures like Roman Jakobson, Cholsky, Eschenbaum, Mukharovsky, and others that we will discuss in due course. So, as we have discussed, that the Saussure is the seminal figure to the movements. Russian formalism, Czech structuralism, and other movements like French structuralism. But when it comes to stylistics, Jacobson became the principal pollinator. Jacobson was the person who spread the ideas of structuralism to different movements. And we also know that the ideas of structuralism, they are very much relevant to the discipline stylistics. So we saw that literariness is important to ascertain whether a work is a literary work. And what do we mean by literariness? We mean that there are some specific properties of literary material that is responsible for that particular work to be called literature. And this is also an answer to what makes literature literature, or what made literature literature. So, literariness is an abstract concept. And if you want to describe that how literariness can be found in literature, then we need to look at literature by its linguistic makeup. That is to say that literature and its linguistic makeup is quite different from other work. And such idea was also expressed by Eschenbaum when Eschenbaum says that there is an opposition between poetic language and practical language. Now, what Eschenbaum said is quite simple, but it's not simplistic. Because we are not talking about only rhetorical devices that are responsible for the poetic language. Because metaphors, rhetorical devices, we also use quite often when we talk to each other or when we use language in day-to-day terms. But here, that is not important. That opposition is not highlighted. And we will discuss what opposition is actually highlighted when Eschenbaum said that there is an opposition between poetic language and practical language. At the same time, we can also cross-question that how this entire discipline came into being. Because the engagement with textuality and texture was weakening. So when literary students, scholars, they were studying literature, they were not talking about text, they were not talking about textuality and texture, they were talking about something else. So in order to highlight the engagement, in order to show that what is actually your profession, what you need to do, this entire movement and later on this discipline, stylistics came into being. Then Jacobson also highlighted that how verbal art is different from other verbal behavior. That is again important. And the poetics is entitled to be the leading place in literary studies. So poetics here means the study of stylistics, the study of those methods that are responsible to ascertain whether literature is literature or not. Now, if you look at the present day scenario, and we see that the modern stylisticians, they are disassociating themselves with Russian formalism. So Russian formalism as a movement we have already seen, and present day stylisticians, why they are disassociating themselves with Russian formalism, that we will look at today. Now, what it says, Carter and Stockwell, they say that the notion of literariness makes no sense within a formalist or structuralist paradigm, since a large part of what is literary depends on the social, institutional, and ideological condition of production and interpretation. Now, this is again a limited view of looking at stylistics, but it is highlighted by Carter and Stockwell, because the present day stylistics incorporates social, institutional, and ideological conditions of production and interpretation of literary work. But what they are highlighting, they are highlighting that what structuralist, what formalist they used to do. So there was a term like literariness, and Carter and Stockwell, they highlight that literariness makes no sense in a manner that we can't find literariness if we devoid the literary work, devoid of social, institutional, and ideological conditions. That means if we are not taking care of the literary work in a particular institution, it is falling. Institution in a sense, like different movements, like feminism is one movement, post-structuralism, postmodernism, deconstruction. So if we are not taking into consideration that thing, and ideological conditions like a Marxist work, fine, a feminist work, if we are not considering that ideology. So that thing is also highlighted by Carter and Stockwell, that formalist and structuralist, they were too formal in a sense, like they were only concerned about the form of the particular work. So it is what Carter and Stockwell said, you can treat it as a charge against Russian formalist or Czech structuralist. And further, we find in Jeffries and McIntyre that literariness is not a quality of a text, rather it is a concept belonging to a specific genre, and that it involves contextual aspects. So again, the meaning is that we can't take literariness as in isolation, as an isolated thing. So it's not a quality of a text. So this is important. Literariness is not a quality of a text, but it's a concept, and it's a concept, and it belong to a specific genre. So we have different specific genre, like different horror is one genre, fine. Humor is another genre. Then you have like animation is another genre, fine. So if we take these type of genre at the same time, like novel, poetry, they are different genre. Non-fiction, another genre. Drama and play, another. So it's a concept. It's a concept rather than a quality of a text. Again, when we say literariness is a quality of a text, again, we are only focusing on the form. That if we have this type of form, then it means it is literature. And if we do not have this type of form, then it is not literature. Because literature must have literariness. So again, mingling literariness with genre is again a contextual move, that we are also focused on the contextual aspects And what about the context? Like, literature cannot occur in isolation. So literature occurs in some social or and cultural environment. So this is again highlighted by Jeffries and McIntyre. Then some critically minded scholars, they also say, and this is mentioned in Ettrich in the book Closing Statement, Linguistics and Poetics in Retrospect. So what Ettrich says that the whole formalist and structuralist movement excludes a major component of the interpretative and analytical process of reading literature. So this is a valid charge that once you are too much focused on the literary work or literariness, then you are not considering one important component who is responsible for the interpretation and analysis of that work, that is the reader. So later on, like when Barthes says the author is dead, that means again giving importance to the reader, giving importance to the interpretation and the analysis rather than the work itself. So this is again a valid point. And this is part of a wider allusion of the cultural determination of literature itself. So why reader is important? Because reader comes with a social and cultural background. When a reader reads a work, then reader is not reading a particular work as a neutral reader. Reader is always filled with his or her social and cultural aspects. So that subjectivity is always there in the reader. So that part is also important. And when formalism and structuralism, they talk about a work, then basically they are talking about how it is made. So they are not talking about who is reading and what mindset that person is reading. So this is again a critical critique to formalism and structuralist movement. But we are not talking about simply the formalism of the past. So what formalists they believe now is more important. So formalists no longer believe in a separation of form content. So now these two things are there. One is form, another is content. So you can understand form content as quality quantity type equation, that you have a form and you have a content. So form is also responsible for content. So there is an interdependency between these two terms, form and content. But rather want to foster the analysis of form itself, form understood as content. So again, this is highlighted that it is not simply the form, it is not simply the literariness we are talking about, but we are also talking about the different genre that is the resultant of that particular form. And once we take into consideration different genre, then we are taking into consideration social and cultural background of that particular work. As such. So what it says further, that literature is precisely that use of language that makes form palpable. Now, what is palpable? That can be perceived through our sense organs, something that is palpable that can be perceived. So literature is precisely that use of language that makes form palpable. Form is otherwise, literariness is otherwise a quality, an abstract thing. But how that is perceived, that use of language we are talking about. So that is basically literature. And if you simply say literariness is responsible for literature, then it's not that clear that what is that literariness that is responsible for literature. So here it makes quite clear that literature is precisely that use of language that makes form palpable. Form is that literariness perceived, that forces us to focus on the verbal texture and structure of the literary work. So through language, through the use of language, we see, okay, it is getting some texture. it is getting some structure, and that particular structure is actually the literary work. As much as on the meanings expressed through its language that prolongs the act of perception and interpretation through its difficult forms. So again, here this perception is highlighted and this palpability is highlighted. And how it is highlighted through the use of language. So now here the first time we are talking about that the use of language that is more important and that is responsible for the resultant, that is your literature. Now in the same line we have a famous dictum. Dictum is a short statement by Sholsky, and what Sholsky says that habitualization devours works, clothes, furniture, one's wife, dot dot dot. So here dot 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 means like we are excluding certain certain things which are not that important here to highlight. Further, Sholsky says that the purpose of art is to impart the sensation of things as they are perceived. Again, sensation is related to perception, and again this word they are perceived is highlighted, and not as they are known. Art is a way of expressing the artfulness of an object. The object is not important. Fine. So again, the object itself is not important, but how we experience that thing. Again, experience is related to one's subjectivity. So let's say a feeling like love. Now the way I feel love is not the way you will feel love, or the way I feel happiness is not the way you feel happiness. So certain songs, they appeal to you, but there is a possibility that they might not appeal to me. Certain literary work that might appeal to you, but not might appeal to me. So this is like art is a way of experiencing the artfulness. And if you cross question that how one can experience that artfulness through the use of language. So that the use of language is more important than the literature itself. So the object is not important. So literature is not important, but the use of language. So once you take a work by Thomas Hardy, let's say the mayor of Casterbridge. Now the mayor of Casterbridge has a significance that the half girlfriend by Chetan Bhagat has not. So both are the piece of art, like they are created. So that object is not important, like the half girlfriend is not that important, or let's say the Merchant of Venice by Shakespeare is not that important. But what is important is that how the writer makes that thing to be perceived by the reader, that is more important. The artfulness, fine, experiencing the artfulness, that is more important, and how one can through language. But what is the problem? What is the problem with a particular piece of work is habitualization. So if a writer is not able to break habitualization, then the habitualization devours works. So it's not only work, but clothes, furniture, one's wife. Now, what do we mean by habitualization devours one's wife? That means like once you want to, once you are in a relationship, then you are saying I love you 10 times in a day. But once you are married and in a year, like you stop saying, and you, instead of saying I love you are just pointing out mistakes that okay, you have this problem, you have this bad habit, now what you are doing, you are stupid. So all those things, so this is habitualization. So that the same thing, like the repeat routine pattern is also responsible for or harmful for relationship. So that is like habitualization devours works. So similar repeated pattern is there, if similar repeated fashion is there, or similar type of furniture is there. So these are the things through which we express our creativity. So each day we have new fashion. So we are not wearing clothes which were very much popular last year or 2 years back. So each day we want to wear new clothes. When we go out, we want to wear new clothes, fine, new attire we want. So similarly, we don't want to read the same type of use of language. So it's not the case like if someone starts copying Shakespeare, or let's say someone starts copying T.S. Eliot, then the person will become T.S. Eliot or Shakespeare. It's not the case. Why? Because that language has already been used. So now the person has to come out from that habitualization. For example, you can cross question like, why sonnets are not important now? Sonnets, like 14-line poems, they are very famous, but why they are not important now? Because Spenser, Shakespeare, other poets, they have written so many sonnets, wonderful sonnets. And if you again copy that form and produces something like a sonnet, then what is new? It is again simply habitualization. So habitualization devours works, clothes, furniture, one's wife. And the purpose of art is to impart the sensation of things as they are perceived and not as they are known. So like the perception must be different, how you perceive those things. So can you think of a way through which you can say, I love you in a different manner? So if you can think a way through which you can change these three words, I love you, in a different manner, that means then you have come out from the habitualization. But again, you are using the same thing, okay, I love you, and so what's new there? So is it a way that you will start loving a person differently than the entire race, human race, is doing? So again, like, this is the thing that we need to keep in mind, that how creative you are in doing things. So that is actually the purpose of the use of language. Now here the use of language is highlighted. Now this is quite important, that use of language is highlighted first time. And that is actually the essence of stylistics, that use of language, not the metaphor. And metaphor is like one word, but the use of language means the verbal patterning we are talking about. We are talking about the syntax, fine. We are not talking about alliteration, assonance, or metaphor or simile. We are not talking about that. We are talking about the verbal patterning that is more important. The syntax is more important than the word itself. That is actually the essence of the stylistics that you need to keep in mind. So one such form is associated with the use of language is defamiliarization, again given by Sholsky. And what is the meaning of defamiliarization? It means like making a familiar thing unfamiliar. Formalism promotes the belief that literature is unlike any other form of language. Precisely because it defamiliarizes the familiar, it makes the stone stony. Now, again, it's a metaphor, like stone stony. So that means like stones, we have seen, like we have perceived stones like thousands and millions of times. But now it's up to you how you can make stone stony. So how you can give stone the quality of a stone through your writing, because you can't change that object stone that's lying in front of you. You can't change, but you need to use the language in a manner that you make the stone stony. Fine. So this phrase is quite important. So stylistic is concerned with the palpability, fine, and unfamiliarity of the language of the literary text, which makes the reality portrayed in it palpable and unfamiliar. So once you read something, you should feel it. If you are not feeling, you are simply reading like a news report, then that's not literature. So if you are not getting images, fine. If something is described, if you are not getting minor details about the character of the person, fine. If you can't think of the clothes the person is wearing, then again, it's not a literary text at all. So which makes the reality portrayed in it. So text itself makes a reality because you read it and you start thinking about those characters. For example, the Twilight Saga. And once you read Twilight Saga, then you the reality portrayed, like there are vampires, fine, and the vampire is in love with a girl, or girl is in the love with a vampire, and the girl wants to marry a vampire, fine. So all such things are reality portrayed and you feel it. Then you have movies that you have watched based on that particular fiction, or Harry Potter series that you have. So that is important, the reality portrayed in it to make it palpable and unfamiliar. And how this palpability and unfamiliarity is maintained through particular verbal patterning. Through a particular verbal patterning. Again, this verbal patterning is important. The use of language we are talking about. We are talking about the syntax. How it is maintained through syntax. So a prerequisite for the power of literature resides in the artful use of language. A sophisticated use of metaphor is not a prerequisite. So again, these are simply tools. These are simply tools like metaphor, simile. They are tools, but they are not responsible for literature. What is responsible for literature? Verbal patterning. Syntax is important. So I stop here, and if you have any question, you can raise your question in the chat box, or you can ask me directly. I will try to answer your questions.